Welcome to Oyate Today. Oyate in Lakota means people. Regional Health is a proud sponsor of Oyate Today. We believe in helping communities live well.
Hi, welcome to Oyate Today. I'm your host, Richie Richards. Oyate Today is produced by Tim and Jackie Gallego. Tim is an enrolled member of the Oglala Sioux Tribe. Our guest tonight is Ms. Linda Anderson, Executive Director of Black Hills Playhouse. Thank you very much for being here, ma'am.
Thank you. It's my honor.
Now, Black Hills Playhouse, well, you've been executive director for 8 years.
Yes.
And could you talk to me a little bit about the history of the Black Hills Playhouse before we get started?
I would love to.
Sure.
So 73 years ago, in 1946, a professor from the University of South Dakota, his name was Warren Lee, decided he saw a lot of kids graduating from his theater classes. And in 1946, there weren't places for them to work. And so his dream was to create a place in South Dakota where artists could come annually to work. And then also, his other dream was to create high-quality professional work so the community in South Dakota would have a place to see professional theater.
Mm-hmm. So you'd have all of these graduates, these students,
yes,
needing some jobs over the summer, more or less.
Yes. Coming. And of course, in 1946, you know, theater, for the most part, professional theater was on the coasts, like in New York and Los Angeles. So he was exporting a lot of students to other places. And it, truly, it's turned into this mecca, in a sense, where people come to South Dakota, work for 13 weeks in a very intensive, artistic, creative situation, and produce really beautiful work.
I wonder what those stories were being told back in 1946 as far as, you know, what type of productions. Do you have any information as far as those and what kind of plays and productions were being put on back then? It really interests me, by the way.
Yeah, it was actually really interesting because where we're located is the site of a Civilian Conservation Corps camp, which was established in 1934. So Franklin Delano Roosevelt created these camps for people during the Depression to be able to make money and send it home to their families. That camp was abandoned in 1942, and then in 1946, the playhouse moved in. But the playhouse wasn't quite formed yet, and so in those beginning years, they actually toured to lots of communities around.
Wow.
And they found out very quickly that that was the most expensive way to do theater.
Mm-hmm.
And then eventually, 2 years later, they were performing in the park. But those first plays were, you know, things that were popular at the time. You know, some of them had to do with Western culture. Some of, you know, they were things that could be done with relatively small casts, with a relatively small budget. And but over time, things got more sophisticated, mm-hmm. you know. So today, of course, we do, you know, really high-quality work. We create all of our own sets, all of our own costumes. The artists come in, professional directors and designers. So, you know, things that you'll see on Broadway, you'll see down the road at the Black Hills Playhouse.
So is this kind of a way for that professional development then, as far as them coming in for this 13-week program, students, community members, graduates?
Yes.
So they come in and get their experience, more or less, or their firsthand experience?
Yes. A lot of times the Playhouse is, we're a nonprofit, non-equity theater. So an artist, especially an actor, and well, designers too, before they can be accepted into professional unions, they have to have a body of work. So many times places like summer stock theaters, like the Black Hills Playhouse, is where people can get those first professional experiences. Mm-hmm. Although 14 members of our company, there are 70 people that come in and work this summer, 14 members are interns, and those are college age or graduate school. Mm-hmm. Everyone else are seasoned professionals. And
okay.
So those interns get to work with the seasoned professionals and then network with people from theaters all over the country.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, that's a great thing. So they can get work after our season.
Sure. And for those of us, or for those of our guests, or excuse me, our viewers who have not been to the Black Hills Playhouse, and where are these productions put on at? And, you know, when is that 13-week period then?
Right. It starts the beginning of June, and it goes through the middle of August, so August 19th.
Mm-hmm.
And we use that period because that's when our university professors and students can also participate.
Okay.
And we're in Custer State Park.
Oh,
and
cool.
So we're right off of Iron Mountain Road on Playhouse Road. Mm-hmm. Very easy to find. Even with GPS now, you can find us.
Yeah.
So we're in the middle of the forest, and it's a gorgeous location.
Mm-hmm. And so we've been talking somewhat about the professional theater, but could you kind of expand on that then?
Yeah. Well, you know, professional theater, you go from contract to contract. And so, you know, we're just one contract out of many for many of the artists that come in. Mm-hmm. An equity theater would be one that where they can get points and they can be a part of a union and then get hired like in film and television and in other larger professional theaters. Mm-hmm. So we're professional because everybody gets paid and we do professional work, but there are, of course, higher levels of professional.
What are some of the productions happening out at the Black Hills this year, actually?
Okay.
This summer, yeah.
Yeah, so this summer we have four productions. The first is called Tokens of Affection, and it just finished. It was a romantic comedy. Mm. And right now, tomorrow, actually Friday night, we're opening the 25th annual Putnam County Spelling Bee. And that was on Broadway in 2005. It's about a spelling bee. It has some audience participation, and it's a little bit naughty. So people,
sure.
It's really funny, though. People
yeah.
will really enjoy it. It's a musical comedy. That goes for 3 weeks, and then we open Oklahoma. And so the play Oklahoma is interesting because it was the first musical in Western theater that actually wrote songs to the story. So before that, people would have a theater, they would have a play, and then they would just put in random music. And maybe the music had nothing to do with the storyline. But Oklahoma actually composed the music the music tells the story. So this is the 75th year of that art form, which, oddly enough, they describe as the Hamilton of its day.
Wow, yeah, awesome.
You know, Hamilton, of course, has taken musical theater to a different level, mm-hmm. you know. So, but we're doing this classic from 75 years ago. And then we're ending with a Sherlock Holmes, The Game's Afoot.
Sure.
And it's a great, it's a comic thriller. It's a murder mystery, and there are some great blood effects.
Ah,
so.
Cool. The visuals. Love it. And so for, I haven't been out there. I honestly have to say I haven't been out there. What days and what hours do these productions go on then?
Sure. So the only day we don't work is Monday. So mm-hmm. Tuesday through Saturday at 7:30, and then we have matinees on Wednesday afternoon at 2 and Sunday afternoon at 2.
Oh, awesome.
So that starts and it goes all summer long.
I'd like to come out and see those. That sounds
We'd
like fun.
We'd love to have you.
Definitely. I'll definitely take you up on that.
Okay.
I want to come out and see these. What would be the mission and goal for the Black Hills Playhouse then, other than to offer an opportunity for employment and or resume building, more or less?
Sure.
What is the mission and goal for this?
You know, I'm so glad you asked me that, because in the 8 years that I've been with the Playhouse, we are really expanding the mission. So the mission is to transform lives through professional theater, mm-hmm. education programs, and partnerships. And, you know, that's a simple way of saying, really, we strive to create meaningful relationships with people all across the state. Mm-hmm. So this professional theater piece just happens for 13 weeks, although we prepare for it all year round, right?
Yeah.
It's a big process.
Yeah.
But then our education programs are year round. And we have a touring theater outreach called Dakota Players.
Sure.
And that is two actor directors who go out and they work with kids in school programs. Last year, we were in 39 schools and communities, large and small. Mm-hmm. Some tribal communities, Sisseton, Wakpala, Allen, others, they go in and they work with kids over a week to either create a musical or to learn about theater through workshops.
Sure.
You know.
And Linda, let's talk a little bit more about that in our next segment.
Sure.
You know, I really do appreciate the arts and theater. You know, I always viewed art as kind of a bridge building, looking across the generations, across the cultural backgrounds, and just bringing everybody together for a single experience. So I appreciate that. We'll
Great.
Talk a little bit more about the educational programming at the Black Hills Playhouse when we get back after a word from our sponsors.
was after his third open heart surgery. Brady started crying and grabbing at his chest. We agreed to call 911 right away. And by the time we got him out to our vehicle, he was completely limp.
He was slumped in mom's arms, got some oxygen on him right away, and he started to come around.
We were pretty scared that we might have to relocate. Buffalo Regional really wanted us to stay here and not have to move to a bigger city.
They've proven to us that they'll be here for Brady.
Our school has great students and dedicated teachers, but we need our community volunteers to help us to provide a broader view of the many ways a good education can point to a bright future.
Did someone say volunteer? Our team at Black Hills is here to help. In fact, we sponsor events and projects, and our employees volunteer for organizations throughout the Black Hills, including partnering with schools to help students learn more about life outside the classroom. Extracurricular, extra fun.
You can't predict life's ups and downs. You just give it all you've got to stay on top. But it's easier with a partner like Security First Bank. Since 1898, we've been riding with you through the country's biggest ups and downs. And this is where we'll stay. Security First Bank, a relationship you can count on. Member FDIC.
Native Son News has been voted the best weekly newspaper in its class for 2015 by the South Dakota and North Dakota Newspaper Associations. You can find a copy of the Native Son News at many businesses and vending machines in Rapid City and the surrounding area, and on all 9 reservations. We publish every Wednesday so advertisers and subscribers can reach our diverse readership by calling 605-721-1266. The Native Son News covers the other side of the story.
Hi, welcome back to Oyate Today. Once again, our guest tonight is Linda Anderson, Executive Director of Black Hills Playhouse here in the Black Hills area. Thank you very much once again for being here, ma'am.
You're welcome.
And thank you for sharing the information about our hidden gem in the Black Hills. So I appreciate that.
Thank you.
Definitely. And before the break, you had mentioned and talked about the Dakota Players. And could you talk a little bit more about that and,
sure.
You know, that relationship with tribal communities that you've taken that program into then?
Yes. So Dakota Players, we recognize that not everybody can get to the theater, right? And theater education or arts education in general is so important for kids. You know, it promotes healthy expression and the ability to work as a team. And, you know, just that ability to think creatively is so important. And so small communities in particular sometimes have a hard time getting lots of theater experiences. And so Dakota Players was formed from a grant for the National Endowment for the Arts. And it's actually been traveling for 19 years in the state. And so when that program goes into a school or a community, I think what's made it so successful is that we really want to meet the needs of the community. Mm-hmm. So we talk to the organizers and we say, what are your goals for your kids? What kinds of things are issues in your community right now that you might want to touch on?
Sure.
Or, you know, and we also always encourage people that if there are students with disabilities, that we want them included. Mm-hmm. Our processes work for both traditional learners and non-traditional learners. Mm-hmm. A lot of times people think that kids or adults with disabilities should be excluded or that they can't do it, and they really can. It's a great environment. So once we've made that connection with the community and the hosts bring us in, they work every day with the students to create a musical. And these musicals are original pieces. We hire artists from the Midwest who create the sets and the music and the scripts. Mm-hmm. And the kids learn that. They learn all the songs. They take home a t-shirt and a CD so they can continue that.
Yeah.
And they perform for their friends and family at the end of the week.
And these topics are really geared toward their kind of their community needs, their school needs, and things like that.
Yeah, or it's, you know, we just finished a tour of a show called The Bard of Ballet Fiddle, and it was about music disappearing in the schools. And so it spoke to that theme. But they're fun and they're light, and kids have a great time, and they belong to something, and they feel the effects. Many of these schools bring us back year after year. And then that's really a beautiful thing because we're able to create long-term relationships, and we know those communities, and we see those kids grow. And sometimes, you know, the goal is ultimately that those kids will be our audiences, and those kids will be our art, you know, some of those kids will be our artists that we work with. So it's this circle, you know, of nurturing. And it's a great program.
It's, you mentioned something as far as the music and arts coming out of schools and not being a part of the curriculum anymore, which is a sad thing in itself.
Yeah.
You know, I think, you know, I wasn't necessarily in love with my experience with the recorder when they had me playing it in the fourth and fifth grade, but, you know, to see it not there and present, and when you talk about non-traditional learners and versus traditional learning, I mean, you're really talking about those kids that need those other forms of teaching, but through music, through the arts, we're learning about life situations, whether it's, you know, cultural situations, social situations, mathematics, geometry, things like that as well. So, and expression, of course. So,
yeah, it's, and it's so important. I have a son who was part of the alternative school system, and he really struggled. And the thing I noticed, the community of students that went to school with him, many of them were creative learners. And so sometimes just the learning style, you know, isn't meshing. And so when they find that creative thing that they can do, it can truly be a lifesaver, you know, and can inspire them to further education. So
that brings up something in my own past, because I remember in high school, in middle school, and in order to be able to really pay attention and focus on what the teacher was saying, I always had a scrap piece of paper jotting down words or
doodling.
Poetry or doodling in order for me to focus on what was being taught in the classroom. So
And I mean, that's a valid learning style. That's a thought process that a creative person goes through to be able to relate to the materials they're hearing and retain them, you know. So I think that, you know, that's when the arts disappear from schools, I think you're cutting out a whole section of creative learners that don't get that. And, you know, we can't totally fill that void with our programs, but we do our best to show schools and to show communities and to show organizations what the arts can do for their kids, with the idea that hopefully the communities will, you know, do more. And they do. I mean, especially tribal communities. I mean, a lot of the tribal communities we go to, I think art is an integral part of everyday life. It's not necessarily like put up on a stage, you know, and that's, you know, so the kids, you know, I don't think it's that foreign for them to work with our processes at all. You know, they're already doing creative things in their homes and with their families and at powwows and all kinds of community events. We're just another option.
Definitely,
for that.
Most definitely.
Yeah.
And then that's a great discussion, because, you know, even as a journalist, as a writer in my 40s now, I mean, I cannot type, I cannot write a article or something I'm working on without music blaring in my ears. It just doesn't happen. So, you know, it's still in some shape or form, it's there, even present in my life as an adult now. So,
yes.
Let's see, let's talk about the Performing Arts Camp. We kind of got away from Black Hills Playhouse there.
Yes,
great
sorry.
Discussion, though, but, you know, let's get back onto what we're doing here.
Right.
So as far as the Performing Arts Camps, could you talk to me a little bit about those, please?
That's a recent thing for us. So these have just been going on for 3 years. We have one camp called Camp Bravo, and it happens at Joy Ranch in Watertown. And the reason it happens there is because it's an all-ability camp. So kids with and without disabilities can participate. If you think about families that have a child with a disability, sometimes it's difficult for them to find things that their kids with disabilities and those without can do together. Mm-hmm. So this affords an opportunity for families to participate together at a camp. And that camp is totally accessible. So they have horseback riding and fishing, and we provide a performing arts component, but everything is accessible for people with disabilities. It's a beautiful thing. And that's in partnership with the Lifescape Center for the Arts.
Sure.
And Lifescape raises almost all of the money for those families to participate. So it's a wonderful thing. There are 40 kids doing it right now in Watertown.
What a great partnership.
Yeah.
We'll talk.
And then the other camps are the performing arts camps here in the Black Hills. So
sure.
Placerville, we have kids going into 5th to 7th grade and 8th to 12th grade. There'll be a little over 40 kids in each camp.
Okay.
And we have wonderful tuition assistance programs. So families should look us up and plan on sending their kids because it's a great experience.
That would be awesome. We'll talk a little bit more about your strategic partnerships. I understand also your office is housed in Racing Magpie in downtown Rapid City here. So we'll talk a little bit about that and an interesting conversation that you had with Clementine Bordeaux. So
awesome.
We'll be back after a word from our sponsors.
Look into my eyes.
Why are we getting killed like this?
Kyle's not here. Got caught drinking beer in the park a couple of nights ago.
Really?
Yeah. Zero tolerance. He's out for the season.
Harsh.
Hey, he knew not to drink. We've made that clear to all of our kids, right?
No, not really.
Bill, if we don't tell them what we expect and why they shouldn't drink, how are they gonna know?
Talk. They hear you.
You can do it if you try.
If youth and family services weren't available in this community, there would be a lot of unmet basic needs. Very few organizations do as good a job as youth and family services, getting every ounce of usefulness out of people's time, their dollars that they donate.
Youth and family services help so many kids. It's a great value to the community.
Join me, because together we help kids.
Hi, welcome back to Oyate Today. Once again, my guest tonight is Linda Anderson, Executive Director of the Black Hills Playhouse. Thank you once again, ma'am, for being here.
You're welcome. Thanks for having me.
It's been an awesome and fun discussion. Thank you. I wanted to talk about a little bit about your partnership, your strategic partnerships that you have in the community and the area. I understand, once again,
sure.
Your office is housed in Racing Magpie. So if you could just talk to us a little bit about those partnerships.
Sure. Mm-hmm. So my board, 3 years ago, made a change in our strategic plan, and they said, they gave me license to do some cool work. They said, we want to reach more people and have more meaningful relationships, and we want you to research how we can best reach underserved populations. Mm-hmm. And so they made that a strategic goal. And about that time, we were looking for a place for our Rapid City office, and I knew Peter Strong and Mary Bordeaux, and they were starting Racing Magpie, which is an artist collective in downtown Rapid City. Mm-hmm. And so we were one of the first tenants that moved in. If you come into Racing Magpie, we're hiding behind the gallery.
Okay, yeah.
But we're there. And it's just a wonderful creative environment where there are mainly Native artists, but Native and non-Native artists, and it's workspace for creative people. It's kind of messy space. We don't have to be too neat. We can be loud.
Yeah.
And it really gives a great opportunity for artists to collaborate with each other and to talk about, you know, what we're doing and then form those meaningful relationships. Mm-hmm. So we really love being a part of the Racing Magpie family. So that's one thing. So mm-hmm. we have that there. As far as other strategic partnerships, I'm actually an employee of the University of South Dakota.
Okay.
I'm the only employee of the university, and that's been 73 years. They have provided a position for the Black Hills Playhouse.
Wow.
And so all the rest of the employees are employed by the nonprofit Black Hills Playhouse.
Okay.
But that's been a strong partnership for 73 years.
Okay. But
we're also reaching out for other strategic partnerships. Racing Magpie and Black Hills Playhouse just finished a project called the Neighborhood Project, where we got money from the South Dakota Community Foundation to go into neighborhoods in North Rapid and create meaningful relationships and try to determine what people like to do and what kinds of arts they may be interested in. Mm-hmm. So we spent about a year and a half going to community events, talking to people, participating in community gardens and other kinds of things. Mm-hmm. And just with the idea that we would create relationships, and it was a wonderful, wonderful thing. Mm-hmm. So out of that, most recently, we've been talking with Clementine Bordeaux and also Larissa Fasthorse. Larissa is a very prominent playwright, and she is from Rosebud, and she works in Los Angeles. Clementine's also in Los Angeles, but her home is Pine Ridge. Mm-hmm. And we've been talking about a form of theater. They work with a theater called the Cornerstone Theater, and the Cornerstone Theater creates community-generated, community-performed theater. Mm. So they basically take 2 years and they work with story circles to understand what are the issues in a community, what do people want to talk about, what kind of dialogue do we want to hear, but what kind of dialogue rises to the top, and they create a play from that. Mm. And then at the end, it's presented for the community. Larissa has a project called Native Nation, and we're hoping we can partner with that to bring that process here. I think in Rapid City, there's, in theater in general, you know, theater, the kind of professional theater that we generally work for is a strong Western art form. But there are theater, types of theater in all kinds of cultures. And, you know, when we talk about Native American theater, traditional Western art forms have misrepresented Native Americans for, like, I have to tell you that.
Sure.
But, you know, this kind of theater, I think the goal is to allow the voice of the people to come forward and to present authentic dialogue.
Yes.
Because, and regardless of the kind of theater or the kind of art form you see, when it's an authentic experience, it's the most meaningful.
It's really about the ownership of the stories.
It's about the ownership.
And coming from the storyteller.
Exactly.
Definitely.
And so we're excited about these partnerships and look for some good things.
Awesome. Well, Linda, I want to thank you for our conversation tonight. I want to thank you for the work you're doing and the work you're doing with the tribal communities. It's very important that, you know, we all do this together. I want to thank our producers, our sponsors. I want to thank Prairie Edge for hosting our show. And I want to thank you for making Oyate Today a part of your night.
You've been watching Oyate Today, brought to you by Regional Health. Wait at all.